Hello everyone and welcome to the last ever Talking Sharks. I know this is difficult, but please try and hold back the tears. There really is only one guest for the occasion. He's been a cherry, he's been a knight, he's been a warrior and of course a shark. But who the devil is this lunatic Evel Knievel wannabe? You're a crazy cat, Kingsley.
Oh, you will.
Where did this come from?
This is a childhood love of mine, motocross. Had a bike since I was about six, and it's in my blood. Can't get away from it. It's good fitness for rugby. Helped me, I believe, in my early years. Strong in my arm, strong in my back, which I needed for a flanker. Unfortunately, this is the second time I've rode this in 18 months. I don't get much chance to ride it anymore.
This little beauty is no moped, is it?
It's not a moped, no. It's a 450 four-stroke Honda. It's probably one of the most powerful bikes you can buy to go off-road.
You've been doing this since you were how old?
6 years old, yeah. 6 years old. It's in my... I tell myself, go sensible in case I fall off, but as soon as I get on it, it's in my blood. I can't help but go fast. We go out the front door, literally. My house overlooked the mountain, so there was terraced houses, a car park, and the mountain, and also old coal tips, slag tips, red ash tips from the steelworks. So you could just literally go out in the morning, the summer holidays, with your bike, a couple of cans of petrol, and spend all day with your mates making tracks or doing jumps or whatever. And as I said, it's when you're young, it's not so bad as well, because when you fall off, you bounce.
We've reunited you with your hobby, because you've not done this for 12 months. But do you find that in the job you're in, more so now as, you know, director of rugby, more pressure? Things like this, it's nice to relax, to get out. It takes your mind off, it certainly takes your mind off something, doesn't it?
It was funny because you asked me to do something with bungee jumping or something on the bike, and I was quite keen to do it, as you knew in the end. I was quite keen for an excuse to actually get out on the bike, because if you guys hadn't asked me to do this, it would have sat in the garage this summer as well. And I mean, it doesn't eat or drink in the garage, it doesn't cost me anything when it's there, but it's a pity to have such a good bike without being used. So it's a great excuse to come out and have a ride. And I really really enjoy the physical side of it as well. It's actually one of the most physically demanding sports in the world, motocross, and it certainly keeps you fit.
Listen, you're going to give me a little lesson.
Yeah.
I will warn you, I have crashed a moped in Thailand before.
Yeah, well, this is a long way from crashing mopeds in Thailand. Okay, well, front brake.
That's important.
Very important, but not as important as the back brake. Most of your braking is done through your gears. We ain't going to get that level with you. Throttle, make you go. This throttle goes right back there. Mm-hmm. You were going to use about a quarter of that at the most. Clutch, left hand. Gears, left foot. Okay? So we'll get you started, get you rolling. For now, steady, no more than that, right? Let it to the throttle.
Ah, you stole it.
This way. You know, right?
Oh, nearly.
The last second to clutch.
I'm scared that I'm just going to rip.
Yeah, you are scared, and you've got to be scared. You ready?
Yep.
Put your hands on top, mate, so we'll put you right there.
Here we go. Easy, innit? Easy, that stuff.
Easy when you get off. I'll get off first.
I tell you, I couldn't have done that on my own. Kingsley Jones, looking back on the season, and we'll keep this pretty short because we've done it all before, we've heard it, but a few weeks after the season's finished, how did it go?
I think I was really pleased with the way we finished the season. Two bonus point wins at home, and a much better finish to the season than we had this time last year. You know, that defeat against London Irish, we still go on about. It's still in our minds. And you and I sat here a year ago, and it felt really, really low because of that performance. This season we finished well, finished strong. I mean,
you know, I've done a season review, I've looked at it in depth, but it's the same as I said 3 months ago, really. The international period is killing us every season. You can't go winning 8 out of 9 and then losing 4 on the trot in the autumn period, and the same in the Six Nations period. And the guys that actually play in that period really front up and work hard. And I've had people raise eyebrows when I say the likes of Scoey, people like that. You can't expect those big men to play 7 premiership games on the trot and be 10 out of 10. It's just, it's unrealistic now. In that period, we had a bad run. We played, 8 games, 6 away from home. And the away from home factor is massive as well. The actual travelling, you know, to leave London Irish or Quinn's, you know, at sort of 5 o'clock on a Sunday evening and then back it up with a Friday at home performance. You can't train well. You've got to look after the boys' bodies. It's not excuses. We've got to make sure that we have the depth to play and get the best out of everybody in that period. I prefer to win 2 out of 4 in that period and maybe slip up somewhere else along the road than actually win 5, lose 4. I mean, it's just no consistency. And what that does for the confidence of the squad and the supporters and everybody at the club, it just knocks us all the time.
Having said that, do you think that the Kingsley Jones team, and by the looks of your signings, which we'll talk about in a minute, they're guys from the Southern Hemisphere, and you need, you know, guys perhaps like a London Irish, that when you do have international periods, you've got experienced guys there that can do a job and you won't be missed as much when the international guys go away?
Exactly. We'll always have 10 out of 10 players, 9 out of 10 top level players, and we have those. And, you know, we have your Hodgson's, Coitos, Tates, Sheridans, you know, without missing anybody out, Wigglesworth, Peel. We've got some real quality in the team. And I know on the outside people are thinking, oh, there's a lot of quality leaving. And that is right, there are. But, you know, and then they say, well, who are we replacing those players with? Believe me, the players we're bringing in are quality players. They might not be 10 out of 10 players, I don't know. They might be 8 out of 10 players, if you know what I'm saying. But they're there throughout the season, and being able to rotate the team, keeping people hungry. Our first 2 years we did that, Philippe and I. And the last 2-3 years with injuries and with so many call-ups, it's really been a big problem for us. And it's the major thing that stands out to me. And of course, I've got a lot of connections with the Southern Hemisphere. My father has been there since 82. I've lived there. I've been back and forth there more times than... So I've got a lot of strong connections, you know. All my family live there, basically. My sisters, one was born there, the one emigrated there. So I'm always in touch with that. And there's some quality players there, tough quality players that come in here for the right reasons. And again, you know, they will be here all the time.
I take it also that the talk at the end of the season in Brian Kennedy's office, as it were, was a lot more positive than it was last year, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think that Brian and Ian Blackhurst and James Jennings, they've tried to take a little bit of pressure off me towards the end of the season. They understand fully the circumstances I've been working in. What can anyone do, you know, when you lose 3 of your first choice props in the international period? And Rob O'Donnell, I mean, I hate saying this because the poor chap, it's his fault, but, you know, a young fella stepping in there, and it's a massive ask to play against Carl Amon, for example. The injuries at Northampton, you know, what can I do about that? You know, you're to lose 4 players in the first 20 minutes. And again, young Will Cliff is called upon. I got more respect, you know, for Will Cliff, Rob O'Donnell's than any of the guys. But it's just the fact that these young lads haven't had the experience. And they're called upon in a weakened side as it is. And they're expected to perform miracles. And it's not going to happen, those young lads. They've got big futures. But, you know, you can't expect to throw young fellas in at the deep end, especially when there's a group of 6 or 8 of them at the same time. It's not going to happen.
It's been eventful already. Are you still glad he took the job?
Listen, and when I was at Doncaster, I finished playing 5-6 years ago, and people asked me about which coaching job would I love. And the dream job for me is to be a director of rugby in the Premiership. I mean, at that point, the dream job was to coach alongside Philippe in the Premiership, and I've done that for 5 years, and, you know, I've been very lucky to be in that position. And you've got to remind yourself, because there's tough days. There are days, don't get me wrong, there are days when you think, oh, you know, I've had enough of this. But it's not because of the things I can control. I don't doubt what I can control. I'm fully confident, back myself, back the people around me. It's the uncontrollables that are frustrating in the Premiership. Mm. You know, the players being called up for international duty. Politics, if you like, and I hate politics and I don't want to do politics. Like France wanted to keep a 23rd man. They've got no right to keep a 23rd man. I get caught up in all that. You know, they want to keep Lionel as a travelling reserve and all these different things, little sightings, which we need to improve our discipline, but sightings, you know, little things all the time. And it's becoming more and more bureaucracy in the Premiership than is mentionable. You know, it's like when I first came, Philippe and I, we didn't have all this paperwork and caper that goes alongside it, and it's becoming more and more. And that's the frustrating part of this job, but it's up to me to put people around me that can deal with those side issues and let me focus on what I believe I'm good at and what will get the best out of everyone around you, and that's managing the staff and the players and coaching the areas I feel I'm strong at. For me, looking forward, it's a new start now. It has been difficult being thrown in where I was halfway through that season, you know. Let's not get away from that. I've had lots of different things to deal with. You know, Philippe's a mate of mine. You know, that was not easy to manage, that relationship. Suddenly, he's been my boss for 4.5 years. And then I'm his boss, effectively, because he still came in and helped out. So, you know, we had players leaving. Players, obviously, Philippe signings and are loyal to Philippe. Of course, they hopefully respect me and they get on well with me. They have done for years. But ultimately, you know, there are different groups that cling to different leaders, and you know, I'm so pleased with the way it's all turned out, because the way that the players turned up in the last two games speaks volumes for Philippe and for them as people. They all were very professional right to the death, and I'm glad we went out with a fight than to go out with, you know, in a whimper.
What ringtone does Kingsley Jones have for the members of the press when they ring his mobile phone? Is it A, Ready or Not by the Fugees, B, Suspicious Minds by Elvis Presley, or C, I Want to Break Free by Queen? So, before the break, we asked you, what ringtone does Kingsley Jones have when a member of the press rings his mobile phone?
And the answer is Elvis Presley, Caught in a Trap. Good choice.
Come September, are we going to see, we know we're going to see, but I guess it's exciting for you that it's going to be even more of a Kingsley Jones team than the one you inherited a few months ago, isn't it? That must be nice for you, that.
Philippe has involved me in everything from day one, so a lot of the recruitment has been through me. You know, obviously there's, I don't know how many Welshmen here, and they've come through my connections and, you know, other players as well. But obviously Philippe has brought some great French and Argentinian connections, have come through Philippe's connections, and it's let's hope we can keep that going, and we can. I mean, obviously Philippe has got strong links there, but we can still bring in players from France and Argentina if they're the right players. The difficulty at the moment for anyone to bring French guys in, Philippe included, would be the market is so strong there, and they're going to have a rule that they have to have 50% of their squad French next year and 75% the year after. Now, that's made a massive impact in French rugby in terms of the market, where the foreigners will become less likely to go to France and we pick those guys up, and the French players are more likely to stay there.
The signings, that's, you know, one thing that the fans always look to in the summer. I think with no rugby, it's what keeps them going over the summer. Are you happy with what you've done so far?
Yeah, very happy with the squad we've put together. We're looking to have 33, maybe 34 senior players, with 6 or 7 younger fellas that really are near the level now.
Let's just talk to the guys that you've got, because I know there's an exclusive one you can talk about now as well. I'm glad I'm not doing commentary on the next season. I can't pronounce any of the names. Rattle off some of the names and why you've got them, basically.
Well, first and foremost, they're really good players. And we signed Mahonry Schwalger, who was a like-for-like player for Bruno, if you like. We've got two very good young hookers. We've got another very good young hooker in the academy set up. And Schwalger's experienced. He's 29 years old. He's 50 or 40 caps for Samoa, Pacific Island International. He's a real good bloke, good man, married man, and someone I think will bring us a lot next year. Looking forward to working with him. He's going to be playing in the Pacific competition through the summer, so we'll see him later in July. We've signed Marika Vakakegzu. I'm with you. I'm going to struggle to say them for a while. The Fijian names are the worst because they're spelt different. But yeah. Marika's a Fijian international, plays fullback, wings, played a little bit at centre for Fiji. He's away as well, playing in the Pacific tournament. He's someone at Pirates in Cornwall who's desperate for an opportunity in the Premiership. And I've obviously, to be honest, watched him a lot this season because my son plays at Pirates. So I've been able to see him play, and he's really impressed me. and the games I've seen him. I got Jason Robertson to look at his DVDs of the games that I'd seen, and Jason watched them and was very impressed. And, you know, he's someone who might be a nice find for us. You know, he's going to have to play well to oust Nick McLeod. I think Nick McLeod's got better and better as the season's gone on, but we need that depth, so that's really exciting. Ben Cowan is a guy who might be in the England team. He seems to think so, which is the attitude we want. And he's got something to prove still. 30 years old, can't buy his experience. And, you know, he's saying all the right things. He's coming back to the UK. And, you know, he had options to join other clubs, but he wanted to join a club in the top end, playing in Europe. And that, to me, speaks volumes for him. He could have maybe gone for cash, more cash somewhere else. But he wanted to still play at the highest level. And I'm looking forward to him being here and his experience again, as I said, will be invaluable to us.
The guy you signed from Cornish Pirates, some of the fans are saying, you know, why are we signing a guy from Division 1? And I know he's had an outstanding season by all accounts in Division 1. What would your answer to that be? Can he step up the level?
This guy's played 15 times for Fiji, and it's about giving people opportunities as well. He's come over here, he's only been a professional rugby player for a year or so, and let's see if he can step up to the mark. How many players have we had that John Carter came from Doncaster in Division 2? And unfortunately for John, with his shoulders, you know, there's other players that get that opportunity to step up. One of the players of the year last year for Gloucester was Ongera. Ongera was playing in Birmingham Solihull the year before, and I'm sure people said the same thing. And he was probably the standout forward in the Guinness Premiership last year, and was injured this season, so we didn't see much of him. So, you know, that's part of coaching, is spotting the talent and bringing them through. I don't want to be. That's part of my philosophy. I want to, as a coach, I want to spot players, improve players and bring them through. The easiest thing in the world is go out and get your chequebook and sign Carl Eamon and all these names. But that's not a magic formula. Mm-hmm. You know, if that was the case, I would suggest that anyone playing Chelsea just gets drunk the night before and don't bother turning up the next day. The point being is that if you look at the size that have achieved this year, Irish, Quins, I mean, they got a star-studded lineup. Don't think so. You know, 2 years ago, a lot of the Irish lads, you would have said, who are they? You know, who's Sackenbow? Who's, Topsy Ojo? Oh, he's okay, you know? Young Armitage, the open side flanker, everyone raves about him. He's come through.
Monier,
and they come through. And they've stepped up. You know, Danny Kerr wasn't playing for Quins 2 years ago. He was just left from Leeds, a young kid. You know, and now he's the best thing in the world. So, you know, anyone watching, part of the coaching job and the biggest part is to spot people, improve people through the academy system and bring them through. And like I say, it's easy to spot people playing and go out and buy them and sign them. You always need to do that. You always need quality in your squad, but I feel we've got enough quality.
Coaches and players leaving in the summer, it was important for you to get the guys that you wanted in, the guys that you're comfortable with. Byron Haywood, a guy you go back a long way with, don't you?
I need to surround myself with people I know and trust, and also bring something to the table. And I mean, Byron's experience, his coaching experience has a lot. He hasn't coached in the Premiership, but he's coached Wales to a Grand Slam at under 19 level, 2006. He's coached Wales under 20s, 2007. He's on the coaching staff with the IRB Wales Sevens,
yeah.
World Champions, may I add. World Champion Sevens, Wales. Did I say that then? World Champions.
Didn't go in the same sentence for me.
So though, it's the first time Wales will be World Champions at the Oval Ball, but it's a fantastic achievement. But
and a circular one.
Yeah, and a circular one.
August, a friendly. Doesn't get bigger than that, does it? Munster away as a warm-up?
Munster away would be fantastic. We're hoping we're going to France, trying to confirm that this morning. Something similar to last year, probably the same tournament, the Vacheron Challenge. Leicester are in that tournament. So we'll have two tough games in France, and then we come home, play Munster away. I think that's a great fixture to have. The more times we can go to Thomond Park, if it is Thomond Park, it's not confirmed yet, but if it is Thomond Park, the more times we go there, the better it is. And we need to go there and put a good show up for ourselves in pre-season. Hopefully, I think it's a great trip for the supporters. And then we've got Exeter home and away as well, and you can raise an eyebrow, Exeter, but I think if you play Leicester and a tough French side and Munster, and then a trip down to Exeter. It's not an easy place to go. Be a nice surprise for some of the players. They've got a big following, and they pushed Leeds all the way this season. You know, there was nothing firmed up until the last three games. So they'll be a tough side, and then we'll play them on the Friday before the start of the season at Edgeley Park.
couple other bits of news to clear up. No Dwayne Peel in the Lions squad. Mike Blair got it. What's all that about?
I really don't know. I think I feel for Dwayne. I prefer that they take Danny Kaye if they weren't going to take Dwayne. So Richie would definitely be going with England, I would have guessed, if that happened. But, you know, you can only control the controllables. It's one man's decision, and I'm not someone who can challenge that. But for me, I'm obviously a Dwayne man and a Wiggy man. And in the end, I think Wiggy was coming close to pushing for the Lions too, the way that some of the halfbacks that were contending had played in the last few weeks. I'm surprised and a little bit disappointed for Dwayne, but as I say, all Dwayne can do now is go and play for Wales in Canada and America. Worst things in life that can happen than actually representing your country in Wales and Canada. And he needs to focus on that, and I'm sure he will. Play well for Wales, and I still believe he'll have the call-up and he'll put that jersey on at some point in this summer.
Well, the Lions squad clearly not picked on form then if Quaits and Dwayne Peel aren't there. But my favourite man, my favourite player, the Fridge, Effian Roberts, back in the Wales squad. Big news.
That's great news, and brings me to the point you said, who are we signing this lad from Penzance when we signed a farmer from Ruthin, Division 6? And he's everyone's favourite now. Played for Wales once this season, and great achievement for him to be on the tour. He's worked hard, he's got his weight down to around 127 kilos. His mother thinks he's anorexic now, so we've got to be careful on him, he's getting a bit small. I'm not allowing him to go back to the farm. His mum will feed him up. He'll put 5 kilos on in a weekend.
I'd put a kilo on when I was there.
Yeah, I bet. That's Welsh mothers for you. You know, they look after you.
Good. And someone needs to look after him.
No, and it's great to see him on the tour. He's really deserved it. So I'm actually going to go over for the test to America and catch up with a few of the people over there and hopefully get a chance to see him play for Wales.
Thank you so much for showing us the ropes with this thing.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. I'll put it back for another year now in the garage. But it was good fun.
And seriously, from the bottom of my heart, all the best of the next year and the years to come. And,
is that why you got your glasses on? Because you're crying.
You look to the right when you light.
You're crying with me, really. You're sad to see us go.
Seriously, I genuinely hope there's some Twickenham finals, some silverware, because you deserve it, definitely, and these guys certainly do.
Thank you very much, Will. Appreciate it.
High five. I love you.
Oh, my shoulder's cramped up. Thank you.
Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Cue the violins, because that is it for Talking Sharks. Thank you all for watching over the last few years. But for now, why don't you trot along and enjoy the summer?
Woo! Yeah!